I've been teaching object-oriented programming to university students for more than a decade, and I want to apologize. Let me tell you about my biggest mistake in teaching. My biggest mistake is that I failed to clearly communicate the why at all times. I read a lot of university student code, and the most common error that I see students make is using abstraction techniques in ways that are not only completely pointless, but actually makes the code less maintainable, in ways that make the code worse. So, as new programmers learn new techniques, they tend to use these techniques for the wrong reasons, which make the code worse. And when I say they, I should say we, because I myself have been guilty of this many times. Sandy Metz has argued that duplication is far cheaper than the wrong abstraction. So her advice is to prefer to duplicate code over using the wrong abstraction. And that's precisely what we're talking about here. If we don't understand why we are using a particular technique, then we might use it for the wrong reasons, which probably will make the code worse. In other words, if we don't understand why some abstraction technique should be used, then we are actually subtracting value from the code rather than adding value to it. And of course, we shouldn't be in the business of subtracting value from code. By the way, when I say abstraction techniques, I mean things like inheritance, subtype polymorphism, overloading, replacing conditionals with polymorphism, dependency injection, and so forth and so forth. But why am I saying that this is such a huge problem? Won't the senior devs around a junior dev help guide the junior until this problem is eliminated? Well, not necessarily. Robert C. Martin has famously argued that the number of new programmers double every 5 years. Whether it is every 3 years or every 10 years is beside the point. The point is that juniors exponentially outnumber seniors, which means that, in the words of Robert C. Martin, there won't be enough teachers, role models, and leaders. It means that we are doomed to endlessly relearn the same lessons and reinvent the wheel, unless we are deliberate in always asking why. It's not enough to understand how to use a technique. We must also understand why we should use it. Let me tell you about a few whys that I think we should talk more about. So, some rules and some reasons. Let's start simple. Static typing is superior to dynamic typing because it moves errors from runtime to compile time. This is the reason for choosing static typing. So, if we're writing code in a statically typed language, then we should try to use types rather than tests, meaning conditionals, to make sure that our application is behaving correctly. I love this quote. In the talk, Make Impossible States Impossible, Richard Feldman says that tests are good, but impossible is better. I mean, it seems to me that it just possibly can't get any more clear than that. In other words, using automated tests or conditionals in our code to check that our application is working is a good thing, right? It's a good thing. But what would be even better is if it wouldn't be possible for it to fail in the first place. If it was impossible for the app to fail. And that's why we have data types. That's why we have compile time type checking, static typing. When we think carefully about our data types to ensure that all the values of our types are values that make sense in the domain that we're modeling, we will discover errors at compile time, which means that it won't even be possible for these errors to ever end up in the hands of users at runtime. So we should prevent errors on the type level, not on the value level. Impossible is better. Next rule and next reason. Method overloading should only be used if the two methods are more readable when they have the same name than if they have different names. Think about it. A call to an overloaded method is resolved at compile time. It is static polymorphism or compile time polymorphism. It's not dynamic polymorphism or runtime polymorphism. So if there's no dynamic dispatch at play here, then what is the purpose of overloading? Well, the purpose has to be to make the code more readable. Let's talk about something more complex. Subtype polymorphism should only be used when we have a conditional where the branches of the conditional are behaviorally different from each other. And when I say behaviorally different, I mean that we have different algorithms, different code, not just different data. Why is this the rule? Well, if we don't have branches that are behaviorally different, then we don't need subtypes to capture the variation. We need objects. If all we have is data variation, then we just need a single class with a constructor that allows us to pass in the unique data. If we still choose to use subtypes when all we have is data variation, then our code actually becomes less flexible, since the data variation is captured at compile time rather than at runtime. Well, what about the second part? Why do we demand that we have a conditional in the first place before we introduce subtype polymorphism? Because if we use subtype polymorphism when there's no conditional to replace, then we don't need dynamic dispatch. There's no place in our code yet where we need to upcast objects of the subtypes to their supertype so that we can treat them uniformly, so that we can dynamically dispatch to a method without knowing which subtype we have, which is the point of subtyping. But if we have a conditional where each branch is behaviorally different, then we need dynamic dispatch. And so it makes sense to use subtype polymorphism. By the way, if you like the way I approach these questions, then you'll probably like my book, The Object-Oriented Way. The book is not done yet, but you can buy and read it now. It's cheaper now and will be more expensive later. Check it out, the link is in the description. Next point, class inheritance. Class inheritance should only be used when we want both hierarchical reuse of code and the subtype polymorphism, because that is exactly what class inheritance gives us. It makes it possible to reuse code hierarchically, and it makes it possible to use objects of the subtype where objects of its supertype are expected. If we need subtype polymorphism, but we don't need to reuse code hierarchically, then we should prefer a simpler solution, like interfaces. In most languages, a class can implement multiple interfaces but only inherit from a single class. So interface implementation is a simpler and more flexible solution. If, however, we need to reuse code in a non-hierarchical fashion, then we will end up with duplication if we try to use inheritance. This is why the reuse that we are looking for needs to be hierarchical in nature. If we need to reuse code in a non-hierarchical fashion, then we should use object composition. We should use has-a, not is-a. What about if we do need hierarchical reuse of code, but we don't need subtype polymorphism? Well, then we should prefer object composition. Again, not class inheritance. This is a problem that should be solved by delegation, by an object talking to an object, object composition. Again, has-a, not is-a. Class inheritance is an unnecessarily complicated solution for this problem because it requires us to make sure that we think carefully about substitutability. As soon as we enable subtype polymorphism, we have to make sure that we don't violate the Lisk of substitution principle, which is not always trivial. Check out my other video on Lisk of substitution principle. So if we don't need subtype polymorphism, we should not put ourselves in a situation where we have to pay the cost of using subtype polymorphism. So if we don't need subtype polymorphism, we should not use class inheritance. What about replace conditional with polymorphism? Well, conditionals should be replaced with polymorphism because conditionals blind us to simpler solutions. In the words of Sandy Metz, conditionals are trying to tell you something. In my words, conditionals are telling us that we haven't thought about our problem long enough to find the simple underlying abstraction where all things are the same and where we don't need special cases. Granted, some problems have unavoidable special cases. But in the book 99 Bottles of OP, Sandy Metz claims that conditionals breed. And I think this is an excellent way to think about it. The number of branches in a conditional tends to increase over time. We start by thinking that we have a regular case and a special case, but before we know it, we have like 6 branches in the same conditional. Conditionals breed. So if we can eliminate conditionals, we should. One way to eliminate conditionals is through subtype polymorphism, but it's not the only way. Next one, type testing is a code smell. Type testing should be replaced by subtype polymorphism because that enables us to guarantee that all callers will support all cases and that all cases have an implementation. Assume that we are checking the same thing in multiple different places of our code, but that we're doing different things as a consequence. Choosing polymorphism over type testing guarantees that we have not forgotten a branch in our conditional and that every branch has an implementation. But if we're in a language that supports type testing pattern matching, where the compiler can also infer whether or not we have missed a case, a subtype, then there's nothing wrong with using conditionals. I don't see any added benefit of switching to subtype polymorphism. Let's do a few more quick ones before wrapping this up. Dependency injection is superior to dependency instantiation, since it allows us to maintain parameterization without duplicating constructor parameters. In other words, dependency injection allows us to eliminate duplicated code. When using dependency instantiation, not injection, instantiation, we have to duplicate code in order to achieve the same level of flexibility that we get when using dependency injection. Next, the principle depend on abstractions, not on concretions, is sensible because that allows us to vary implementations at runtime. Next, the principle of composition over inheritance is sensible because very few problems are truly hierarchical. So we often end up with duplicated code when choosing inheritance because we fail to realize that we need to mix behavior horizontally. So in regards to my biggest mistake in teaching, I apologize for the error of my ways, and I vow to do better. Let me know if you would like to deep dive into any of these topics. Link to my book is in the description. It's not done yet, but the price is cheaper now than it will be later. Subscribe.